Hi, everyone. Welcome to this week's Bible Talk with Pastor Paul. The truth will set you free, but the truth ain't what evangelicals say that it is. I went with the ain't, even though it's not in the copy there, because my Missouri roots were coming through just a bit. But I'm glad you're with me on Pastor Paul's Bible Talk today. This is where we talk about the Bible. And as we're pursuing emotional and spiritual well-being in unconventional ways together in the Pastor Paul community, I love to take the evangelical Bible, the scripture that we all sort of grew up learning, and showing how it doesn't say what we were told that it says, but it does say amazing things with amazing wisdom. And that's the idea of this Bible Talk. And it's a part of the pursuit of the unconventional spiritual life, an unconventional ways of pursuing emotional and spiritual well-being. And this is what the schedule of pursuing that spiritual life looks like all week, with our mindfulness moment on Wednesday, our time of mindfulness and contemplation together, contemplative prayer. Hope you'll join me for that. That's at 6:30 on Wednesdays. All of these times are on the website, pastor-paul.com. Thursday is the post-evangelical podcast. Had a great guest, Bob Prater, this week talking about the insurrection and evangelicals on January 6th. And then every Saturday, you may be watching this on Saturday or some other day, we release the Bible Talk for the week. And then our Sunday community, for those who haven't left their faith behind, just their community of faith behind, we get together online on Sunday mornings. And then once a month, starting in 2022, on the third Tuesday of each month, we will get together and have what we're calling unconventional conversations. And that happens the third Tuesday of every month. So that is the pathway to the unconventional spiritual life. Hope you'll join for that. But right now, let's talk truth and what it means to you and your identity on this week's Pastor Paul Bible Talk. Well, you will know the truth and the truth will set you free. Oh my gosh, it's such a common passage out of the book of John in the Protestant Bible, chapter 8. In fact, I hear it when I hear it. I have so much of my King James Version youth roots still in me. I hear, ye shall know the truth and the truth will set you free. Truth is such an interesting thing in our culture today because nobody can agree on even what truth is. We don't even know what facts are anymore. We have to have fact checkers because somebody in the Trump administration told us there were alternate facts that could be believed. And a whole huge group of people that we saw gathering together on January 6th believed it, that there are alternate facts. In fact, all the time when I'm interacting with my right-wing Christian friends on social media, I hear it all. They're all, check your facts, do your research, never realizing that the facts and research that they are reciting word for word most of the time are just coming out of their dependence and indoctrination of a media that helps cater and coddle and grow an indoctrination to a religious partisanship, a religious political ideology. And so it's so important when we talk about John chapter 8 that we know what did Jesus mean when he said truth will set us free, because if we're going to be set free, which I think all of us want to be, we need to know what truth is. And so part of what I do in these Bible talks is I take passages of the Bible that we know particularly and say, you know, the way we were taught to read them may not exactly be the right way to read them. So as we're pursuing a really good and powerful 21st century emotional and spiritual well-being and a spiritual life, we need to know what our texts are really telling us. So let's start by looking at this passage in the Bible and let's read it together so that we know what we're talking about in John chapter 8. So I'll just start reading. Whoops, I'm not there. It's 8:31. And it says this. You even see the heading in the Protestant Bibles. This is the English Standard Version of the Protestant Bible. It has the heading, which those weren't in the original text, by the way. Those were put there to help Americans focus and Westerners focus. It says, the truth will set you free. John 8:31. So Jesus said to the Jews who had believed him, if you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. And they answered him, we are the offspring of Abraham and have never been enslaved to anyone. How is it that you say you will become free? And Jesus answered them, truly, truly, I say to you, everyone who practices sin is a slave to sin. A slave does not remain in the house forever, but the Son remains forever. And if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed. I know that you are the offspring of Abraham, yet you seek to kill me, because my words find no place in you. I speak of what I have seen with my father, and you do what you have heard from your father. And then he goes on to say, and by the way, you know who your father is? Your father is the liar or the accuser or Satan. So let's talk about what we're reading there in that passage. And it's really important. And I've had some interactions with some Jewish friends and rabbis on my social media recently. And I think it's very important for me to say, when I speak against the religious system that Jesus spoke against, I am not speaking against Judaism. I am speaking against any religious establishment that tries to impose its belief systems onto others. I am perfectly fine with anybody carrying any belief system they want. And I believe God can find you in that belief system, that heaven can partner with you in any belief system that you're in. So I'm not going to tell you your belief system is wrong or right. You can be in any of those belief systems as long as A, you're not hurting someone else by doing it, and B, you're not trying to impose that religious code onto somebody else. And it's part of what the problem of what we saw on January 6th is evangelical Christians and Western Christians, to some degree, to a broader extent, believe it's their job, their godly duty to impose their religious belief systems onto others. And I believe when Jesus is talking about being set free here, in some ways, he's talking about being set free from a belief like that, but not in any way do I want you to hear that I am being critical of Judaism, because I'm just not. My Jewish friends, I'm learning a lot from as we're talking, and we have to be careful that our Christian language, as happened with Martin Luther, who was the, you know, sort of the father of modern Protestantism, who had some very anti-Semitic beliefs, doesn't become ahead for us in this belief shift. This is not an anti-Jewish teaching for me from the New Testament. Anything I say about religion is I am against any religious establishment that wants to bring shame and imposition of law on to others. So what are we reading about here in John chapter 8? Well, the evangelical belief of ye shall know the truth, and even some commentaries I read about this passage this week, says just blatantly, truth is Christianity. Truth is becoming a Christian. To believe the truth is to adopt the Christian religion. And if you do not adopt the Christian religion and the Christian belief system that goes with it and hang out on church 4 Sundays a month, you are a slave to sin. But in no way do I believe that's even close to what Jesus is saying here. Jesus says, you'll know the truth, and by knowing truth, you'll be set free by that truth, not enslaved to a new religion, not enslaved to another religion, not enslaved to a whole new set of laws and rules. You're going to be set free of all of that. And the interesting response here that you see from the group is, we've never been slaves. We're sons of Abraham, which is an interesting belief system for a number of reasons. One, it totally denies that our Islamic friends are also of the lineage of Abraham, of Abraham's first son, Ishmael. And so it's saying we're sons of Abraham because we descended from Isaac, and therefore we're safe. We're never going to be slaves to sin. So it's totally ignoring that lineage. And any Christian would say, I'm also a descendant of Abraham in that my religious belief system also descended from Abraham. The three major religious belief systems of the world, Islam, Judaism, and Christianity, all descended from the relationship between Abraham and heaven. And in some ways, we ought to say, we are truly all brothers and sisters out there. We are truly all cousins related to each other because we proclaim Abraham as the father of our religious belief system. But these people are saying, no, we're sons of Abraham because we're due this special dispensation from God because of our racial and religious heritage. They were religious people who believed our side is right and everyone else is wrong. And their identity was built into that belief. I am good because I'm a part of this community, of this belief system. And Jesus says, if your identity comes solely from a shared identity of a shared communal belief, then you are a slave to the beliefs of that group. John 3:17 said that Jesus didn't come into the world to condemn the world. He didn't come into the world to force it to come into agreement with the belief system, but came into the world to sozo it, which is a Greek word, to reconcile it to its original purpose and intent, to totally transform it in a positive way, body, mind, and soul. Jesus didn't come to impose a new community on people that they would have to be a slave to. That old community is bad. Come be a slave to my new community. The old law is bad. Come be a slave to a new set of rules. To say slave to sin means that you're a slave if you drink too much alcohol or are addicted to caffeine, as most Christians are, and thank God for caffeine. That then you're a slave to sin is to say we've gotten rid of an old set of rules and we're now wanting to put people in bondage to a new set of rules, to our rules, because our rules are superior and being built in a belief system around our rules sets you free. But you see that it doesn't do so because you're now going to have to be a slave to that new religious belief system to be okay and a part of that community. What we need is to get an identity based entirely on the covenant of Abraham that came from heaven saying, hey, humans and heaven are now in partnership together. And I've done other Bible talks that you can go back and see on the Pastor Paul YouTube channel that talk about this covenant between Abram and God that was a model for, okay, now heaven and humanity, this is how the partnership of the two works, not in a religious sense, but in a God that's not a man sitting on a throne doling out rules, but a spirit of heaven, a spirit of goodness, partnering with humanity to say it's no longer going to be about governance of rules, but governance in relationship together. So if you can learn to walk in that partnership with heaven, you are free indeed. That is the truth that will set you free. The truth that Jesus actually was saying is you get to be in partnership directly with heaven yourself. You don't need a priest. You don't need a community belief system to get you there. You will get there all by yourself. And so let's look at how this bondage of communal belief system works today. As I was saying, this is being recorded on January 7th. What we observed this week was a solemn anniversary of an attempted overthrow of our country. And I did a TikTok about it this week, and I want you to take a look at it. So let me show that to you now to give a feel of how I look at this idea of being in bondage to a community belief system. And we even saw this in action on January 6th. So for those of you watching on YouTube, check out this video.
Good bride, but something touched me deep inside the day. The music died. So bye bye, Miss American Pie. Drove my Chevy to the levee, but the levee was dry. And then good old boys were drinking whiskey and rye, singing, this'll be the day that I die. This'll be the day that I die.
So we see there, let me shut this off, a group of people that say, hey, we're patriots and we're free. We're fighting for freedom. And I would ask, do they look free to you? They have shared clothing. They have a shared leader. They have belief in all that leader says or the media tells them to say, and they recite it word for word, and they have to believe all those things. And the second they stop believing it, they get ostracized by friends and colleagues. They have believed they have freedom in following a truth that they are to overthrow a government because an election has been fraudulently held when there is absolutely zero evidence, no facts, no research you can do to make it true. Yet they have this identity of being part of a MAGA crowd. They even have the hat, the lingo of socialism is bad. They, even though many of them don't even understand what the word is. They have leaders like a Representative Kevin McCarthy, who's out here, who has to, you know, once he starts speaking the truth about what happened on January 6th, has to go visit the leader down in Florida and apologize for telling the truth. Or this absurdly pathetic moment with Ted Cruz, a Republican Christian senator on Fox, apologizing for telling the truth about January 6th, because to belong to the community is everything. And the second you don't hold the same belief system, you are out of the community. So Ted Cruz has to grovel like a dog on Fox News, begging people to forgive him for telling the truth about January 6th, because he is a slave to the sin of a community. He is a slave to the belief system of a community. Even if the belief system were good, he would still be a slave to it, because the community would say, you are out. By the way, Christian leaders, if you're not calling this stuff out right now to set your people free from this bondage, that is on you. That is a sin against the partnership of humanity in heaven, of the kingdom advancing, of the gospel being shared, because you are the antithesis of what Jesus came to say. He said, I set people free from the bondage of that religion, the truth that you don't have to be in a belief system to have identity. Is the truth that will set you free from bondage to that. You see, the truth will set you free is an exhortation from the Protestant Christian Bible that calls people out of a mob mentality. I say the mob is basically never right. The mob always misses the mark. The mob on January 6th, some people are like, I don't even know how I ended up inside the Capitol building. I just was there and I just kind of went with the mob and all of a sudden there I was. And some of those people are in prison today because they are a slave to the identity of their community. So how do we come out of this mob mentality into the freedom of our own identity? Well, it's coming out of a belief system by challenging one's own beliefs. I always say Romans 12:2 says, don't be conformed to the age or the bubble or the era that you're in, but be transformed by the ongoing renewing of your mind so that you will know what is good and right and perfect in a season. You have to consistently be challenging, renewing your mind, challenging your belief system so you can be transformed to where heaven and humanity are going together in a season. Those listening to the teachings of Jesus in John 8 said, we are the sons of Abraham. Therefore, we're safe as being a part of this community, of this closed belief system. And Jesus told them, you know what? The unwillingness to challenge that belief system makes you a slave to sin, and it makes you hard-hearted like your fathers were in the desert. And so it's very important that we learn how to be transformed. And I'm going to talk about that more in just a little bit. But first, I want to talk about something amazing that we have coming up. And I have a little video I'm going to play, but I'll tell you first, it's called the Am I Happy webinar. Am I happy? Am I even supposed to be happy is a key question to transformation. And we have a webinar that's coming up on Thursday, January 13th, Saturday, January 15th. Those will be the same session, so you can choose one or the other. And we'll talk about what does happiness look like and how do I find it? And is being happy even the goal? of our lives. And so I hope you'll join for that. And I have a video that I'll show you about what this means. Am I even supposed to be happy? Is it okay for us to care about ourselves? I call living in this way the airplane mask theory of life. It's important that when that airplane mask falls down, they tell you to do what? Put yours on first. If you don't put your mask on first, you might not have the resources to help anybody else. It's the same with our emotional and spiritual well-being. If I'm not taking care of me, I'm not going to have resource to provide good help and support to others. It's even in the commandments of Jesus Christ in the Bible when he said, love your neighbor as yourself. The implication in that is if you can't love yourself, how can you love others? If you feel uncomfortable with the question, am I good? Do I deserve good things to happen in my life? You and I need to hang out. That's why I want you to check out Pastor Paul's coaching in my Reconstruction You coaching cohorts. We may be deconstructing some of our life, but now we're reconstructing into what do we look like in the next season of our life? What do we look like when we put on our oxygen mask and start to maintain our emotional and spiritual well-being? And I want to tell you more about it at a webinar I have coming up called Am I Happy? Am I Even Supposed to Be Happy? You see, we have two sessions coming up in January, and I'll be telling you what it looks like to coach with Pastor Paul in a Reconstruction You coaching cohort. You can find more information at my website there, pastor-paul.com. Don't forget that dash, pastor-paul.com. And as well as being able to find out more information about the webinar, sign up for the webinar, and also find out more about my Reconstruction You coaching cohorts, don't tell anybody. You'll get to visit my brand new website, which the public isn't going to know about until later in 2022. It's a little bit messy. There are still things being designed. You may find some mistakes. You may even find some broken links, and you get to be my web team to help fix all of those things. And in the meantime, find out about the Am I Happy webinar. It's absolutely free, and you'll find out more about how you can jump into coaching with Pastor Paul for this next season. Listen, you are good, and you do deserve good things to happen. Let me show you why with coaching that'll start to change your self story, your identity, and the mindset through which you interact with the world. That can be your story. Let me show you how through coaching with Pastor Paul. Again, pastor-paul.com is the website. And come join me for the webinar, and let's make your New Year's resolution stand up this time. So that's what it looks like. And by the way, for all the work we do here at the Pastor Paul community, I don't take up tithes and offerings. I don't take up donations in the sense of what a missionary would do. I sell subscriptions and give services, coaching, and otherwise. But even if you just say, I don't have a lot, but I just really would like to support that schedule of ministry that Pastor Paul does, you can do it by those of you watching on YouTube, just point your phone at the screen on that lower QR code, and that'll take you to the pastor-paul.com website. And if you hit that support button in the upper right-hand corner, it'll show you how for just $5.99 a month, you can make a huge difference as part of the community. Or maybe you say, hey, I just want to give money one time. Then there's my Venmo QR code. You can pay me through Venmo and just give a donation to help. Not tax deductible, by the way. We're a for-profit ministry, but the blessing is still there as you are helping us walk this through. And so I hope you can do that. Remember, pastor-paul.com. You can go there to help or give one time through Venmo, and I will be forever, ever grateful. Thank you for letting me take that short break. My kids do have to eat and go to college and do all those things too. So let's get back to the truth setting us free in John chapter 8. At the beginning of that passage in John 8, 31, the passage called for followers of Jesus to abide in his teaching. So as we're looking at what truth is, and that truth is setting us free, not from the sin idea of don't drink, don't chew, don't date girls that do, but rather sin being allowing ourselves to be in bondage to a communal belief system or an old mindset that's no longer serving us well. So Jesus is saying, see, the contrast to that is abiding in my teachings. So what does abiding in teachings? And again, the evangelical teaching would be, well, that means you get the list of rules and you live by the rules as best you can. And by the way, you're dirt, so you're not going to be able to do it. And so you just hope that God doesn't strike you with lightning in the meantime. And maybe by the skin of your teeth, you'll get into heaven. I think Jesus is talking about something very, very, very different here. The first century Jewish thought of how religion would work is you would be a follower of a teacher, of a rabbi. And to be a follower of that teacher's teaching, I might say, I'm a follower of Rabbi Ted, or somebody would say, I'm a follower of Jesus Christ. And that's where the Christian came, when they determined that they believed Jesus was the Messiah. They called him the Christ, and they became Christians. That meant we walk in the name of Jesus Christ, which means we abide in his teachings. We will look like him because we will live out what he taught us to live out. And, you know, some of the other might say, I live in the name of Rabbi Ted or Rabbi Bob or Rabbi Joe or whomever, because being a follower of Jesus doesn't mean to say a sinner's prayer and go to church on Sunday. It means to look like Jesus said to live. The word Christian literally means little Christ, or one trying to look like Christ. So if you say, well, I've said the sinner's prayer and I'm going to try to be better, but, you know, screw everybody, you're not truly abiding in Christ. You're living in a belief system that has a set of rules that allows you to be a part of the community as long as you agree with those rules. And the second you no longer agree with those rules, you're out. And the truth that Jesus is talking about here in John chapter 8 is to be able to abide in the words of Christ, to live out the commands of Christ, to love our neighbors and our enemies as we love ourselves. And the conclusion is that true freedom and strength doesn't come from choosing the hard-heartedness of being in my closed community belief system, but comes from a knowledge that safe community is the realization that inclusion and tolerance of all people, all flesh, all beliefs is where true safety and power lay for us. So we need to be transformed so that we can abide, so we can live, so we can walk in the teachings of Jesus and not be hard-hearted. So how do you become transformed? Well, that word transformed means to challenge your mindset. And in Romans 12:2 says, to be able to know what is good and right in a season. I love the movie Gran Torino, if you've ever seen that movie. There's a character played by Clint Eastwood in what is a great movie, and his name is Stanley Kowalski. He's a Korean veteran. And so he had this mindset built into him that Southeast Asian people weren't quite as human as the Westerners, the Americans that were there fighting in a war. And so because of that, he was easily able to dispose of these people he saw as subhuman so that he could fight and live and do his duty. And in his belief system, his mindset told him, those people are less than me, and that is what got me home alive from Korea. But as he was living in a neighborhood that was starting to diversify, and these wonderful Hmong people moved in next door, his belief that they were subhuman, that they were less than his community, started to be eroded by seeing them as like, whoa, these actually are pretty amazing people. And as he started to allow that mindset shift to come in, that transformation, that mind renewal, Stanley Kowalski in that movie Gran Torino suddenly not only gained some new friends who lived right next door and made amazing food, but he gained a new purpose for living and even a willingness to die for those people. See, the idea of sin isn't violating a code. Don't drink, don't chew, don't date girls that do. No, sin is walking in improper relationship with God and man, believing that those people are somehow less than you, believing that those libs are trying to steal the election because you're told so by your community, is to be slaves to sin. But to step out of that and say, I refuse to be enslaved to that belief system. I refuse to look at those people, even as those people, we start to come out of that slavery and bondage to a community narrative. And not only can we start to walk in right relationship with people and no longer be in bondage to a slave to sin, but we can find renewed reason to live altogether. we find that safety isn't being in a closed community. Safety can actually be when all of us start to walk in our true identity and are no longer in bondage to a religion, but can love one another no matter what our beliefs are. I'm reading an amazing book right now called The Bible With and Without Jesus. And it's written by a Jewish Bible scholar and a Christian Bible scholar. And they're working together to say, let's look at how each of us looks at how scripture goes. And they said this amazing thing that's just really been rocking me this whole week. They said, the way the relationship of the Jewish community with scripture says, we're in community and we will always be in community. So let's view scripture from that aspect of that community. And what does it mean to us today as we're moving along in history? So because they're not just built around a belief system, but built around community, even an atheist can be a part of the Jewish community. Isn't that amazing? Christians, on the other hand, live in relationship with scripture in another way that's like, here's what scripture means, and you have to agree with me about this belief or else we cannot be in community together. And so out of that comes these belief systems of inerrancy or absolute truth that start to say, you either believe this or you're outside the community. And so asking questions, allowing your mind to be renewed, becomes a threat to the community. And so hard-heartedness starts to settle into the community, and you can start to believe very terrible things that lead to an insurrection on January 6th that has all those pictures of people holding up in God we trust signs or Jesus save signs while they're trying to overthrow democracy in the United States. They are in bondage to a belief system. And you know, this idea of absolute truth, I remember James Dobson from Focus on the Family, a man who I believe has probably done more damage to young Christian children with this teaching of purity culture and absolute truth than many people have done in the history of the world. God isn't walking with us in absolute truth. That is going to be a jarring statement for some of you to believe, but the Bible does not teach an absolute truth. It actually teaches the opposite. How do I know? How do I prove this to you? Well, let me say this. If you knew of a woman tricking her father-in-law into having sex so she can be impregnated by him, would you say that was sin today, if you're a Christian evangelical? Well, the answer is yes. Any well-knowing, well-meaning Christian evangelical is going to say, yes, a woman tricking her father-in-law into having sex with her so she can have a child is sin. Well, do you know in the Bible, that's not a sin for the woman Tamar who did that with her father-in-law Judah to be impregnated with his child. And in fact, Tamar is in the Matthew 1 lineage of Jesus. She is a great, 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 great grandmother of Jesus, and her child is in the lineage. The child who came from this trickery of Judah into having sex with her is in the lineage and inheritance of Jesus. So absolute truth would say, absolutely, it is wrong for a woman to do this. But even Judah in scripture says she is more righteous than me because I violated relationship of how it's understood in our culture. She kept going with the relationship with our family. So absolute truth moves with history and culture of people saying we're in community together. What does scripture mean to us today versus people saying here's absolute truth. You either believe it and agree with me or you're out of the community. Which sounds more Christ-like and godly and good to you? To be in that belief system and say you agree with me or you're out is sin to relationship and sin to relationship with God. The truth is, you're not a slave to anything. You don't have to be a slave to any bondage of any community because you are amazing. You are fearfully and wonderfully made. We see this in Isaiah 6, where Isaiah is standing in front of the throne room of heaven. He sees this majestic picture of heaven in his imagination. And he's just like, oh, this picture is so amazing. And my community narrative tells me that if I look upon heaven, if I see God, I'm going to die immediately. So he hits the ground and says, I don't deserve to be here, because he is a slave to this community belief system. But then suddenly he is touched with fire from the throne room of heaven, and his and he is freed from that community belief system. And heaven itself says, no, you are not that person. And in fact, then heaven says, who is going to go out there and take the message of heaven? And Isaiah, this guy who's on the ground saying, I don't deserve to be here, jumps up and says, me, I'm the guy. I'm the guy to take the message of heaven. And you can see that in me talk about Isaiah 6 and some other Bible talks that I've done. But it was that transformation of identity from Isaiah. We know what your community belief system says, but we're going to show you why that's not profitable for this next season for you. You are a slave to that communal belief system, and you don't need to be a slave to that belief system anymore, because we need you to understand your identity so that humanity and heaven can walk together in perfect relationship to bring that goodness of heaven to the world today. And nothing in that is an exclusion of something else. Don't be a slave to any community mindset. The evangelicals are wrong. You do not have to agree with them to be good. I promise you. Jesus' teaching is to set us free from that bondage. And I encourage you to be set free indeed. Don't forget, you can go to my website and jump on there and be a part of the Pastor Paul support community for just $5.99 a month. There's a community chat board on there. I'd love to hear your thoughts on this teaching I'm giving. What does this mean to you? If you have any questions from what I taught, you can go on there and ask me those questions. This is where we're going to interact, and this is how I earn my living to keep doing this as well as the coaching I do. And so I hope that you will be a part of that. Just point your phone right at that QR code with the Pastor Paul in the middle of it, and it'll take you to the website, pastor-paul.com, and you can join in there in the conversation and all the other resources of our website. I hope you will do that. Let me bless you and tell you that you are amazing. You, your identity tells you that you get to walk directly in the throne room of heaven and be in partnership with the goodness of heaven, so you can bring that goodness to the world around you. And anybody that tries to enslave you to any community mindset, a political one, a religious one, or otherwise, is trying to bring you in bondage to a sin, a sinful relationship with humanity around you. And just tell them, heck no, I'm not going to do that. I'm too amazing and valuable to let that happen in my life. And I bless you to know that you are amazing, fearfully and wonderfully made, and God declares you good, so you can live as one striving to look like Christ, a true Christian going forward. Blessings to you. We'll see you again throughout the week as we pursue emotional and spiritual well-being together in the Pastor Paul community. Take care, everybody.